I tell you, since I was here last, the devil has really worked on me. But I've learned so much. Now, instead of giving you a sermon today, I'm going to give you a testimony.
Amen.
Is that all right?
Amen.
And it's a testimony that I feel the Lord gave me as a result of this illness. I've learned that sometimes some of us are thick-headed. And we don't learn. So the Lord says, okay, like Paul, I'm going to knock this man off his beast. That's the only way I can get through his head who I am. So with me, he said, all right, now, Lord, you've been rooting and running for 50 years up and down, preaching this and preaching that. I need to just let you sit down in your house and get this Bible and get it in your head.
Amen.
And that's what I've learned in the last 2 or 3 years I'm going to share with you. All right?
Amen.
Now, please don't become offended by anything I say. I'm really giving you my experience for me, but I'm sharing it with you. So don't think, well, he's up there talking about me or he's up there criticizing somebody. Some of the things that I tell you, you may not like. But I can back up and prove from the Word of God almost everything I tell you. Lord, be with our message today and bring some soul to Jesus is our prayer for Christ's sake. Now, the theme of our camp is preparing for the end, right?
Amen.
Okay, now, the end is going to come when Jesus comes, or the end is going to come when you pass away, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, in this whole thing of life, the Lord has revealed to me that no matter what I've done or what I did do, I had been deceived. Who? Me? Being deceived? And what I've learned is when I sit and read the Bible close, it's telling me something that God wants me to know. Now, when I read Revelation 12, 9, it says that the devil deceives the whole world. I'm in the world, aren't you?
Yes.
But back, you know, back there then, oh, that ain't for me. That ain't, I ain't been deceived. I got the truth. Don't we all have the truth? See, you all got, we got the truth because you keep the Sabbath. But who said he's the truth?
Jesus.
Wait, who said that again?
Jesus.
See, I'm saying I got the truth. And I got the truth because I am a Seventh-day Adventist and I keep the Sabbath. So I got the truth. See, in the Bible, read the Bible, Jesus said he is the truth. And what I discovered is the devil fits a deception for every group of people and every person in the group. So he knows who you are. He knows where you've been, he knows where you come from, and he designs a temptation to make sure that you don't meet Jesus. That's that rascal's job, to make sure that you don't meet Jesus. And he's designed a temptation for Seventh-day Adventists to make sure that we don't see Jesus. You say, that ain't true, because I see Jesus all the time. Now, this brother got up this morning, and he talked about the horn, right?
Amen.
Now, the devil, in the Bible, has worked through this horn to deceive the whole world, and that includes Adventists, and Adventists, bless our hearts, we've been just as deceived as most other folk on Jesus. Now, I'm going to read the Bible and give you some thoughts, so just kind of sit still. Now, when it comes down to the end. Jesus has given us a plan to save us. Everybody you see wants salvation. Everybody you see wants to go to heaven. Everybody you see wants to live as long as they can. Hospitals, doctors, nurses everywhere, they got plans and pills and all of this to help people extend their life. But thank God, he has given us a plan to live forever, the plan of salvation. And it only comes through one person, and that's Jesus Christ, and the devil knows that. So he says, all right, since you got the plan, I'm going to work on all the citizens of the earth to make sure they miss that plan and come with me. Now, there's one thing that's really I'm weak on. And because God is who he is, and we are human beings who we are, we don't think like God wants us to think. Now, God says, my ways are far above your ways.
Amen.
And I don't think, let me read that text to you. Isaiah 55. I'm going to read these texts here to you and just pull out God's thought. Isaiah 55, verse 6 through 8. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous his what?
Thoughts.
And let him return unto the Lord, and he will receive, he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For that my thoughts are what? Are not your thoughts. So there's something ingrained important about thoughts. The thoughts are in your head. Huh? Now, the thought that's in your head is what God is interested in, and you and I are human beings on this earth, and we're always interested in what we do. Now, he's interested in the thought in your head, and you're interested in what you do. Now, the devil knows that. He says, now, God is interested in the head, and I'm going to get busy, make sure that they're interested in what they do. So, at least for Seventh-day Adventists and other people who are religious, we're all caught up into what we do. Tina, that's where I was. All my life in ministry, I was taught to teach the people to do. So I'd go and I'd run tent meetings, and I'm teaching them what to do. The Lord don't want you to do that. The Lord wants you to do this. All the 27 beliefs, don't do. Now, God is interested in your head. And I'm telling them what to do. And my mother used to always tell me, and she was an excellent Bible student, and she knew the Lord. She said, listen, the people need to find Jesus. Now, I'm in a tent, paid to preach what to do. If Jesus would come to town, what church would he join? I'd make it plain through convincing folk that he joined the Seventh-day Adventist church. And she said, people need Jesus. She said, when I go into the man's house and he's smoking or drinking and he's carousing around, I just ask him, now look, now Jesus has done so much for you. You don't love that cigarette more than you love Jesus, do you? And the man would say, no. You don't love that whiskey more than Jesus, do you? No. He go dump the whiskey out. So way back there then, the Lord is just now got through my head that going to be with him forever has to do more with my head than what I do. And when he comes in my head, I will do what he wants me to do. I'm going to read that to you.
Amen.
So he says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. You worrying about what to do, what not to do. I'm worrying about your thought. I'm worrying about what's in your head. Now look. Now, the biggest thing with God is faith. Now that's just not getting through to my head. Faith. I can't see faith, can you? Can you see thought? Can you see thought? Let's go to John. What book did I say?
John
3. Yeah, I got so much to tell you. I can't tell it all to you at one time. John 3. Now here is Jesus. And what I've learned is that Jesus is giving me through his 33 and a half years in this world all that I need to go and have eternal life. All that I need. Now in this example of Nicodemus, Nicodemus was just like me. And just like you. Nicodemus went to church every Sabbath. Nicodemus paid his tithe. Nicodemus kept the law. Nicodemus kept the Sabbath. Well, something was wrong with Nicodemus, according to Jesus. Not according to Nicodemus, but according to Jesus. Something was wrong with me. I did the same thing. Went to church every week. I mean, I don't think there was a Sabbath holiday I missed. I might have been sick once in a while, but I was there every week. Paid my tithe. Uphold the Sabbath. Oh, I kept the law from stem to stern. All that. But something wrong. There's something wrong up here. Because that's what God is. He's dealing with my brain. Jesus comes along. And the experience of Nicodemus, and he shows me that you keep the Sabbath, you keep the law, you pay your tithe, but there's something wrong with you, us. Huh? Now wait, now hold on now. John 3:3. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Verse 5. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water. See now, I was taught that the most important thing was baptisms. Oh, you got to baptize. Baptize. It's important. But Jesus said, baptize with water. And spirit. I wasn't worrying about no spirit. I'm worrying about the water. The conference said, baptize. So I baptized. My name was at the top of every list on the baptism. How many of you baptized this year? 55. How many of you baptized here? 75. And the theme was, coming through college, you wanted to be a centurion. Now, a centurion was baptizing 100 people. If you got to baptize 100 people, you were somebody. The Son of God said, if you want to be somebody in my Father's sight, you got to baptize with water and spirit. Because he done told me he don't think like I think. He said spirit. That's something you can't see. See, God is interested in your head. Or he's interested in stuff we don't see. We are interested in things that we can see. Paul comes along and says, if you can see it, it's not faith. Huh?
Amen.
So if you can see whatever it is, you don't need faith. And what we do is we look at what we see. We see baptisms. Oh, people are baptized. They put it in the Adventist Review. Oh, we baptized so many. Oh, we started so many churches. Oh, we baptized, we had so many baptisms over wherever they had. We baptized 2 million. We lost 100 and some odd thousand. something they see. Jesus said, I'm more interested in what you don't see. And he said, baptism of the Spirit. Now Nicodemus was confused, just like I was confused being a man just like Nicodemus, until the Spirit taught me. When you're baptized by the Spirit, that's something you can't see. But Jesus made it plain. The way you know you've been baptized by the Spirit is by the evidence of it. Evidence of it. See, now, remember what I told you. The devil is out to deceive. See, as long as you think that you're doing or not doing or doing or not doing, you're all right. The Spirit, you don't have to be baptized. But if the Spirit is in you and controlling you, you're a different person. You've been born again. Huh? You are changed. What are you changed like? You're changed into the image of Jesus. Oh, the devil don't like that. Oh, he hates that. For you to have genuine love in your heart for your brothers and sisters. Oh, he despises that. Oh, he doesn't like for you to have peace of mind. Oh, he hates that. So he gets you busy. I got to go here. Got to do this. I got that meeting. I got to all this doing or not doing. And you ain't got no Spirit. There's no evidence that our hearts have ever been changed by the Spirit of God. Now listen, John, what book did I say again?
John
14. John 14, and I'm looking at there's only a lot of verses. John 14, 5 and 6. Now listen, I'm going to meddle in your business in just a minute now. John 14, 15, 16 and 17. If ye love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth. What is the Spirit of truth? That's something in your head, truth. You can't see no Spirit, just like you can't see the wind. You see the evidence of it. There's something that you cannot see. And listen what Jesus says. For the Spirit, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not. I didn't see it. Neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he what? No, he dwelleth outside over there somewhere. No. He dwelleth only in the church building.
Dwelleth with you.
Dwelleth in you and shall be in you. Verse 20. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye are in me, and I in you. The Spirit that you can't see wants to come and be in you. You can't see that. You can't see no Spirit being in you. But you know he's in you because it acts like, looks like, behaves like Jesus. Huh?
Amen.
You can't see it. You see the evidence of it. Oh, you say, how in the world that person can love that man after he done talk so bad? The Spirit of God is in there. How in the world can they get along together? You see, it's foolishness for Christians who have the Spirit of God abiding in them not to be able to get along. Because one of the evidences of the Spirit living in me is the Spirit of peace. Peace. Peace with people. Peace with myself. I can't get along with him. I can't get along with her. I'm going to get a divorce. Something's wrong somewhere. Jesus in one of them, or may not be in either one of them. See, that's foolishness. See, remember now, God is more interested in what you can't see, but there's evidence that is in there. He wants to live in you and abide in you, and when he lives in you and abides in you, there's always truth. Huh? There's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Amen. That's Jesus. Amen. But there is another name according to man under heaven that we exemplify all the time. What is that name? Now you don't want to say it. Paul says, I didn't come up to it, he says. I don't want to know nothing else other than Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's all I want to know. That's all I want to talk about. That's all I exist for. Preach Jesus Christ. Now, with us, the biggest name is Adventist. Who? Don't worry. Let the people come in and sit down. The biggest name with us, Adventist. According to my Bible, the biggest name is Jesus. Amen. According to Paul, after he got knocked off of a beast, after his beast, the biggest name, Jesus. That's all he said, I want to know. Won't you tell me nothing else? I don't want to know nothing else. Jesus. 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 With us, because we have been deceived for 6,000 years, is church. 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 Adventism. 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 Where did Jesus go? Where did he go? The magazines. Church. Jesus. What did the conference say? What is the conference doing? Now all this noise around the world. What, all going to San Antonio? They ain't talking about no Jesus. Amen. What are they talking about? Ordained and women. Now why are you going to spend millions of dollars to talk about ordained and women? What does that have to do with Jesus? Whether Jesus, whether they you ordain them or not ordain them, there's no salvation in that. I mean, we are forever talking about stuff that God is not concerned about. He says, my ways are not your ways. I'm interested in what's in your head. And you are interested on this earth in what you can see out of your eyes, touch with your hands, or hear with your ears. Can you ever get that through your head? I mean, what's wrong? And I'm talking to myself, with me. That's all I was thinking, knowing, doing. Now listen. John again. 6. John 6. You see, because of that beast, the devil, we all messed up. Now listen, Jesus has just taken a fish and some fish and some bread. And he had just fed 5,000 people. Now Jesus, seeing me and you, in telling me something in this story. John 6:26. Fed 5,000, and even when he got through feeding the 5,000, took up baskets of empty fragments. And Jesus answered them and said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not because ye saw miracles, but because ye did eat of the loaves and were filled." Now see, I've been reading that story for, I ain't getting it out of it. I mean, I got some out of it, but I ain't get what I'm gonna give you out of it right now. You see, we are so used to looking at stuff through our eyes till we don't see the real point behind. Now, they had just seen a miracle where all these people had been fed that actually stunned them. And Jesus knew that was in their head. Said, "You ain't really followed me for that miracle you just saw me do. You followed me because of that bread that you just put in your belly." And that's the way we do. We don't see stuff that is spiritual. Jesus had just worked a miracle. Jesus had just stop the car accident from happening to you. He had just miraculously given you a job. And then you seeing how miraculously you were saved or given a job or helped or blessed, you see the evidence out of your eyes. And you miss the point that God is trying to get through your head. So he comes on down and says, "Labor not for the meat which perishes." See, all of us are after stuff we can see. And everything that we can see is going to perish. It's going to be disintegrated. It's going to burn up. He says, "But for the meat which endureth," where? "Unto everlasting life." See, the Lord is always after everlasting life. He's always after trying to promote us or to get us to get on the same wavelength with his Father so we can have eternal life, because that's what we want. But we want it our way. We don't want it his way. He said, "If you're going where I can go, you're going to have to follow my Father. And my Father deals with your head and not with what you see." Listen, going on down to verse 28. "Then said they unto him, What shall we do that we might work the works of God?" See, they weren't about what to do. Man, I got to keep the Sabbath. Man, what I got to pay my tithe. Man, I got to go out and pass out these tracts. Man, I got to go out and give these Bible studies. Now, Jesus could have said, like I've been saying, if you want to do the works of God, you got to come on and keep the Sabbath. Oh, you got to join the church. Oh, you got to do this, do that. Now, this is Jesus, the Son of God, was asked what to do. Listen what he says. "And Jesus answered and said unto them, This is the work of God, that ye believe on him who he has sent."
That's right.
If you want to do what God wants, you let your brain get on the same wavelength of the man who sent him. Now see, I've been reading this all the time, but I'm just now dawning on me. The thing that God wants is for me to surrender my heart to him, my head to him, then invite him into my head. And when he comes into my head, he controls what I do. He does that. Now, I can't see it, but I see the evidence of it.
Amen.
And he said it's free. You don't have to be rich. You don't have to be, you can be poor. You can be sick. You can be whatever. I'm dealing with the way you think. And I know if once I get in your head, I will control what you do. You will keep my commandments if I'm in your head. And you not only keep them the way I want you to keep them, you won't keep them the way the Pharisee wants you to keep them. I'll pay your tithe. You'll pay tithe the way I want you to pay your tithe. See, that's what you don't understand. See, the devil is he's a trickster. See, he'll deceive you, and then after he deceives you, you don't even know you're deceived. He's just that slick. We got you thinking about keeping the Sabbath, paying the tithe, keeping the law, and that's going to save you. Now, the end, for example, end, Seventh-day Adventist, and we good Bible students. Now, I'm going to meddle in your business. Oh, we good Bible students. We good prophecy. We good at all that. And that's good. But I've discovered that everything about this Bible, somehow, God has been trying to get it through at least my head, and I think your head, that if you are going to live with God, you got to believe in what he says. Be faith. Faith. Trying to get that through your head. In the Old Testament, he just, you know, for example, he said, I know the snakes bit you. Take the snake and put it up on a stick. Hold it up there. And anybody who looks at the stick, the snake on the stick, will be healed. Now, to show you that they didn't believe it, they wouldn't say, I wouldn't look. And they wouldn't heal either. Just that simple. See, it's just simple. See, as time comes along, man is putting burdens on folk to make them think that they got to do certain things in order to get the salvation that God has promised by faith. It's a gift. So through the centuries, it's been added on. Got to do this. Got to do that. Got to do the other. Now with Seventh-day Adventists, he says, now look, I got a special trick for them. Now they're always reading, always studying. Oh, they got to know every prophecy. They got to know all of them up and down to 20 days, which is good. But what do those prophecies do? They get increase your faith about Jesus.
Amen.
See? If you don't get the point of the prophecy about Jesus, you don't miss the point. And the devil has been so successful in helping us to miss the point. So we start off with the image. Daniel, Medo Persia, Greece, Rome. That's all it means. And oh, we smart. We can tell all the details about it and all everything about it. And then we come down to the bottom of it. We say, oh, it was smitten by this stone that it was hewn out of a rock. Now we just kind of dwindle it on down to that. That's the whole point of the whole image. But we know all about the image. We know all about the beast. We know all about the 2100 days. Now what we're weak on is knowing about the sanctuary, but we're not involved in it. All the prophecies talk about Jesus' phases of his work that he has done for man, what he did for man, and what he's going to do for man.
Amen.
The whole Bible, the whole thing, God says, if you can get that through your head, I will bring you here with me when I come back. The Bible is like this big GPS. For 6,000 years, looked at the whole thing. And all during time, he GPSs Isaiah. He GPSs Jeremiah. He GPSs Ezekiel, the different parts of the people. And he had grace enough and love enough to GPS us with Ellen G. White. Ellen G. White looks at stuff from 1844 on down to the end. And God is telling me by faith, listen to what the woman is telling you. I'm trying to get her. I'm telling her to tell you. And the whole thing started off. They were looking, watching the prophecies, watching what Jesus was doing. Found out he was in the sanctuary. Do you believe it?
Amen.
Don't believe it. So it got so smart now. It's about the corporate business. Got so smart now. Oh, we don't have to believe that no more. Now, little did I discover until recently that the corporate Seventh-day Adventist Church literally does not believe that.
That's right.
Now, I didn't believe that before, but I didn't know literally. I didn't know literally that one of the General Conference presidents declares all that we learn from prophecy has been put on the trash heap of time. And that's the reason why the preachers coming out of the colleges don't talk about it. All through our Adventist system that we've been grown to love and cherish and adore and to point folks to has gone right back to that bee's horn that he's talking about. Now, I wish I had time to talk about it. I know you got me on TV, but I don't want to get into too much with that. But we have all gone back into that, corporately speaking. And the message that God has given through GPS now to us, we don't know nothing about it. Ignored it. Forgot about it. Oh, and the devil is just rejoicing. He says, man, I got these folk now. He said, we got down to the end of this thing, and the main people who was talking about it, they don't even talk about it no more. They don't even believe it no more. They don't even want it no more. I'm going to get them talking about women's ordination. I'm going to get them talking about this. I'm going to get them talking about whatever they want to talk about. I'm going to get them all caught up in this. I'm going to get them going here. I'm going to get them talk about all everything, but I don't want them to talk about this. Because we down to the end of this thing. And I know it, and God knows it, so I'm going to work to make sure that they are deceived and fooled. Because in the sanctuary is where your life decision comes. Every last one of you and me. Your destiny is decided in that sanctuary if you believe it. Now, if you don't believe it, man, there. Remember, it's in your head. Devil want to take it out. No, you ain't got to do nothing. You can go and have a good time. Now, let me read you something. Go to Romans. And I'm almost through. Romans 3. Now, this is one of the most blessed things we can hear. Romans 3, 23 through 25. Romans 3, 23 through 25. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All means everybody, don't it? Being justified freely by his... Being justified freely, what? By his grace through the redemption that is within the Seventh-day Adventist Church. If I am justified or made right with God through Jesus, why in the world ain't that the most important thing that I can talk about and think about? Huh? I don't understand that. See, what I've discovered is everything that is highlighted in the Bible by Jesus that I need to know, talk about, believe, and accept about Jesus, folk don't want to talk about it. Talk about everything. Go here. Go there. Join here. Join there. Where do you, if you read your Bible any at all, did you see anywhere where Jesus said join something? He just said follow me. Amen. Just follow me. Did you ever read where he said that you had to belong, go to, join anything other than him? Well, why is so much emphasis on joining something else? Well, we're going to spend, we're going to raise up so many churches over here. See, listen. When you read the history of synagogue and church, they are the assemblies that discuss and talk about the Messiah or Jesus. And it doesn't have to have a name on it. That's right. See, that's the way the devil fools us. Put a name on it, and then go out and tell somebody you got to belong to it. Well, that's what he does. Put a name on it now, and then you go out there and tell him, now look now, go to the Bible, you got to do, join here. Go to the Bible, you got to join here. Jesus made it simple by telling your head, if you want to be with me, trust me, believe me. And if you don't know what to do, I'm going to live in you, and what comes out of you will be in harmony with this Bible. Amen. If we, I, me, could ever get that through my head. So what I need for the end of time, I'm assuming that you need to. And what you need is more faith. More faith. He's given you the plan. He's shown you the plan. He shows you what he did. He shows you what he's going to do. And he says at the last end of it all, I'm going to justify you in front of my Father in heaven if you can get that through your head. I will tell my Father in heaven that you can't see. So you ain't got no faith, you don't believe it. You can't see me up there, but I'm up there with my Father telling him about you because my spirit is in you. And when my Father looks at me, he will see you because you're in me. You are justified, redeemed by my grace, by what I declare to my Father by faith. And he told the Seventh-day Adventists, now listen, through Mrs. White, just go and tell people that you are free because Christ made you free by his grace. Amen. Just go tell them. And bless your soul, in 1888, the devil got anything, twisted it all up, and instead of telling folk that we're saved by grace through Christ alone, they said, what you need to do is go out and tell them what to do. List it down, tell them what to do. Keep the law. Keep the Sabbath. Pay your tithe. Don't eat no hog meat. Take off your rings and stuff. Just tell them that. And so the whole point of Jesus being able to save us from our sins by faith and grace alone been all forgotten. Devil is slick. So my prayer is for me. Lord, help me to read that word and believe what it says. Take the emphasis off of do and put it on faith. Amen. And when I got faith and he lives in me, what I do will come out like him. Amen. My life is free. Ain't worried. Ain't burdened by what to do. Because he's telling me what to do. And when he tells me through my head, through his spirit, what to do, I do it. Amen. Of course, Paul comes along and tells us there's war in there Because the devil through the flesh don't want the spirit to supersede him through your flesh.
Mm-hmm.
See, so there's war in there. And you got to decide who you're going to listen to. And Jesus said, if you listen to me, you're going to be all right. But if you listen to the devil, you're going to hell.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Now, that's just how the Lord has summed it up in my experience, because this stroke. I didn't see that like that all the time. And I can understand when I see my dear folk talking about what to do and worrying about this meeting over here, and we got to go over here, we got to have this, we got to go there. I can understand all that. But after all that going and doing and coming and going and all that stuff, how much better are you to meet the Lord in the end? We ain't no better. But if we all have the faith, and the faith is the thing that's going to take us through. And the faith must be exhibited, because what we're headed for through our eyes, if the faith don't match it, you ain't going to make it. I mean, the devil got something game for us that we can't make it. And only if your faith is strong, you'll be able to go through what the devil got planned for you. Paul is an example. So my prayer is, Lord, give me more saving faith that I might live with you and you might live in me. So what comes out of me will be just like you. That is my prayer. That is my appeal for you. That's my goal. That's my aim. And when we live by faith, it brings so much peace.
Right.
Jesus went around and said, peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. People don't always say that. Because he knows good and well when he lives in a person, there's peace there. Ain't no fussing, ain't argument. The churches nowadays are full up with nothing but foolishness. Arguing about this, arguing about that. Putting people out here. Oh, you don't believe like I believe? Get out. See, that's nonsense. That's nonsense. Devil just standing back laughing. My goal is to be saved in God's kingdom, and I desire that each one of you might have the faith of Jesus and might be saved in his kingdom.
Amen.
Amen.
Father in heaven, we thank thee for the words that we've read from your holy word. And we thank thee, Lord, that we have hope with you if we can just believe what you say. Bless all of us where we are. And when Jesus returns in the end, save us at last, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, just one more thought. You understand, I hope you do, that the organization of Seventh-day Adventists has been put on a path to reunite with the Catholic. You know that, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Ah, good, good, good. I ain't got to get into it then. I ain't got to get it. Stump keeps you informed on that. No, really. Really, not that serious. See, nobody don't want to talk about that now. See, so you know that organization is headed right on back into that Catholic Church. Well, that's the whole world. But I'm just saying, we who are against it are now all of a sudden cozy back up to it. See, all the way from the schools to the churches and everything, they got this spiritual information that they agreed on to teach in the schools that come from Loyola of Chicago to make sure that you don't understand the Bible the way it is, and that you don't have nothing to do with the spirit of prophecy, and that you can get all this nonsense, bring it into the schools. So the preachers that preach out, they don't preach the Bible no more. They preach nonsense.
Amen.
Now, I'm glad you know all that. And just be faithful to the word.
Amen.
And if somebody puts you out, don't worry about it. I got a book that I got there the other day. From the early Adventists, who wrote in there, is it necessary to belong to a church? And the man wrote, but Nichols wrote back and said, no, it ain't belong. We live in a free country. As long as you belong to Jesus, you're going to be saved.
Right.
See, but that ain't what I thought. See, remember what up there you said in my head? That they taught me you got to belong here. Right. If you don't belong here, you ain't going to make it. See, and most Seventh-day Adventists think that. Mm-hmm. They worry about it. Oh, do I need to belong? Oh, they put me out. Oh, the way that thing bothers them, they can't sleep. But you are, nobody gives you eternal life but Jesus.
Amen.
And unless you got him, you ain't going nowhere anywhere, sitting up in the church. God bless you, and thanks a lot.